Okay, so welcome everybody on the session after dinner. I hope you are woken up by the music at least. Let me introduce myself first. My name is Paula Januszkiewicz, and I am from Poland, as you probably recognize by the complicated surname. And I am an MVP on enterprise security, MCT, and I'm one of these people that has access to a source code of Windows. And I'm definitely, I would say, on the bad side, which means I do not work for Microsoft, which means I will try to tell the truth and the only truth about the operating systems. So what do I do for a living? I'm a penetration tester, and basically that's it. I also deliver trainings and this kind of consulting services. Security is boring, so that's technically it. And we're going to talk today about 10 deadly sins about security that IT people usually do whenever they are managing the infrastructure. And this is what I see in my regular life whenever I'm doing the penetration testing. I've collected 10 the most deadly sins, and I've put it in the presentation. So my goal for today is that if you could take at least one sin and repair it, if that's something that you have in your infrastructure, and I believe that at the end, everything is going to be a little bit more secure than it is right now. So a couple of things. This is our agenda. As you see, it's pretty simple because we're going to talk about what people do, 10 deadly sins, and that's it. So not very complicated. Let me ask you one question. Sounds familiar, right? I hope it's not in your infrastructure, but maybe at your client's infrastructure. But imagine the situation. Somebody, you know, admin is in a vacation. Somebody calls him and it's like, oh, we got a network problem. And he will say, like, take this yellow cable, right? So this is a sin, right? So we're going to discuss this kind of situations, that whenever admin makes some problems, makes some troubles in the infrastructure, usually this is a situation that can lead us to really, I would say, sometimes huge security breakthrough. Okay, so first sin, and let's do not make it obvious, is that IT administrators, they do misunderstand how passwords are used. And that's something that you probably heard like many times, use passwords that are complex enough and so on, blah, 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 boring. But every time you put a password somewhere, it means technically that you share it with somebody, right? When you put it to the domain, then you share it with domain controller. When you put it as a password for LinkedIn, now the situation, yeah. So you share it with LinkedIn, and so on and so on. So the idea is that we are not prepared, usually, for the situation in which whenever we lose our password, then what? Are we done? Or maybe do we have some backup solution? So this is what we are discussing here. Okay, so let me show you a small demo with the passwords that never sleep. But before we switch to the demo, I would like to share one story with you. So please put your hands up if you remember the time of NT40. Oh my gosh. It's like 80% of you. That's interesting. Okay, so this was the time of NT40, and there was a tool that is called Loftcrack. You know it? Yeah, okay, of course, you know it. So if you were an IT administrator and you were from that time, Loftcrack appeared to the market, you were like, I would like to test it out. On whom? On our users, of course. So this was the story that was happening in one of the consulting companies. There was a girl, Kate, she was working in a reception desk, and the consulting company basically consists of men, IT and so on, look around you, right? Only men, almost, are here. And there was this Kate. And one of the admins I've talked to made a testing on the consultants. And it appeared that the result of the Loftcrack was that, like, vast majority of people working in this company had somehow the word Kate constructed in the password. That's a social engineering, right? Okay, so I would like to show you a couple of things regarding passwords. Let me switch to my domain controller here. And the problem is, and I do have, the problem is that, as I said, we misunderstand the password. And some people share on their sessions candies, like Swedish people. But I'm from Poland, and except for vodka, that is not very legal to share here, I've brought you, I'm pretty sure you know it, what Poland is famous for. A sausage? It's a really good one. Okay, so the question is, and if you answer the question, I'll give you a sausage. The question is, who checks for the password complexity? Nobody? Nah. Oh yeah, the group policy, that's the good thing, but what kind of DLL? No, Gina, well, Gina, no. Password filter, you said it. Awesome. Sausage for you, okay? Yeah. Tell me what you think. Okay, so, what do I have over here? It's, of course, Active Directory users and computers. And the password filter is actually called in the operating system a notification package, so that every time I do change a password, let me actually reset a password, and I will change it to ABC123, and click OK, I am notified that the password is not complex enough. This is really interesting, and the question is, how do we know it? Because if you want to check for the password complexity, it means that you are not checking actually on the hash, right? You are checking on the password. So somewhere in the memory, oh, I will make it simpler, somewhere in the memory, there is a password being checked on if you do have a capital letters and so on. So password is actually, let me tell you, on a clear, with a clear text on the domain controller. Okay, so with this positive accent, what I will do, I will change the password for one of the users. But first, let me go here. Yeah, and over there, I'm gonna have the txt file that's gonna pop up with the password of one of the users during the checking for complexity process. So, I do have a Britney Spears, and I will reset her password to password that is complex enough. Okay. I'm notified. Great. Let me jump here. This is this file that appeared, and this is the password of Britney Spears. Yeah? So, how that is possible? It's a kind of man in the middle for a domain controller. So it's possible because I do have my DLL working there in the memory, and the DLL, it's simply speaking, working as a password filter, and it's checking out for complexity, but additionally, it's saving the password to the txt file on the drive. This DLL is a little bit more evil, but we're gonna be back. Okay, so the second thing is services. And I'm going to create a service using sc-create. And I need to put a name, so let's say Tahed. And I'm gonna put a path to the service, which is bin path equals, and the service is gonna run on Windows system 32 notepad.exe. Great. So I will find the service over there. Let me refresh it and sort by the description. This is the service. And the regular problem in the companies is that the service is running on the account that is not a built-in account. So it may be, for example, administrator, and sincerely, whenever people install SQL Server, they usually put an administrative account just to make sure that we have enough privileges for the database. You know the issue? Yeah, okay. Of course, many people also use the other accounts, but whenever I see this kind of situation happening in the client side, I'm super happy because my job is done, and then I can, you know, go to the pub and drink a beer or whatever. So I will put here administrator with the password, very secret one. Awesome. And I do not plan to sort it because the notepad is not written to talk to service manager, so it won't start anyway, but password, it's already saved. So I'm gonna use my toolkit. So first I'm gonna use psexec. This is a tool that is written by Mark Rusinovich. And I'm gonna use it with the S switch to impersonate myself into the local system account, which means I will have more privileges than the administrative account, of course. I will make it interactive so that I can talk to the service, and I will open this in the separate window so that you could see better what is happening. And I'm gonna run cmd.exe to have the console running with the local system account. Let me show you. And I am anti-authority system, which means that I can do a little bit more. Use it only when you are in a situation that you need something very, very special, like fight with malware and so on. Usually it can be a little bit dangerous because we do have really high privileges here. Okay, cool. So let me switch to the root drive. And then I'm gonna use SAPD tool, which is a tool that is written by my friend. He's a developer, and once he said that he would like to make my life easier, and he wrote a tool for me so that it's very easy to get. I will show you what in a while. You see? The password? Okay, so the problem is that if the machine with SQL, for example, with the service running on the not a built-in account is offline, who cares? The service needs to be running. So if this is a domain's admin account, I can steal this machine, go out, and do my job. Another problem is, in many companies, users, they are domain users, but additionally, they're also local admins. Have you seen this situation before? Yeah. So if you've got this kind of situation and you were running services on the domain's admin account or on whatever account, not a built-in account, this is what you have in your infrastructure. It's just for a start. Okay, so any questions so far? No? Good. Let me switch to the presentation. The next thing, it's an offline access that we are really ignoring. I know there is nothing fancy in the offline access, really. So of course you can, you know, delete Windows folder and so on, but it's not that fancy as you would like to see this probably. There are many things that can happen during offline access. For example, somebody may inject something. The DLL that I showed you how it works during the first demo, I'm gonna explore it a little bit more on my next session tomorrow. We're gonna do kernel level debugging and so on. But this is a DLL that was actually injected using the offline mode. So I'm going to show you a couple of things regarding offline mode, including the very practical situation. Who of you happened to forgot your admin password, domain admin password? Yeah, who of you happened to forget your domain admin password? Couple of people, okay. So what do you do then? What is the solution to reset your domain admin password? Okay, so a couple of voices. In general, you need an offline access, and I'm going to show you how to do this. But if you would like to be an evil person, then, of course, you may rename the files, inject the files, and so on, but IT people will probably get the message. So I will show you the way how not to be detected and still be able to reset a domain admin password, okay? So, let me switch to my machine. Yeah, that's the raccoon. Okay, so I do have here ISO image connected, and I'm going to boot up to the Windows installation folder so that I could rename several files and be able to reset a domain's admin password. Okay. So let me reboot. And additionally, I would like to show you a very tricky tool. It's actually a new tool that was issued a couple of weeks ago. It's called Mimikatz. And this is a piece of malware also that can work offline and online that can allow you to dump hashes of the user accounts in the operating system just like this, being in the offline mode. So that's pretty scary. Okay, so let me run the Windows PE. Yes. And I'm going to connect to the registry. So let me do next. Prepare your computer. Yes. And I do have here 2008 or 2. Next. And command prompt and regedit. And I'm going to connect to the registry that is offline. So now this is the registry of Windows PE. So what I need to do, I need to go to File, Load Hive, and I need to go to the exact registry file that is on the disk. So I'm opening the D drive, which is the operating system files, which are, yeah. And then I'm going to Windows. So let me actually browse through the structure, Windows, and System 32. And to browse through registry, where should I go? Config. Let me open it up. And here, you've got branches that are the real registry branches. You can edit them however you want. You can inject whatever you want. And I'm going to open up the software branch. So let me open it. And as a key name, you may type blah, blah, blah. It doesn't matter. It's not saved anywhere. And I'm going to local machine, blah, blah, blah. And then I'm going to Microsoft, Windows, and T, current version, and to something that is called image file execution options. Let me expand it. So what's that about? It's actually called, in the regular language, image hijacks. And if you would like to debug one piece of software with another one, this is the place to go. So what I will do, I will create a key, new key, and I'm going to call it Utilman. .exe, and over there, in the key, I'm going to create a string, oh, not a binary value, the string value, new string value. I'm going to call it debugger. And who will be the debugger? CMD.exe. This is what you want, right? You want a console. Okay, cool. So at this stage, my job is done, but what I would like to show you also is that I would like to go to the D drive. Let me go to my users folder. So it's going to be users, administrator, and then it's going to be desktop, and then it's going to be Kiwi. And I do have here a couple of files that I can use to dump the hashes of users. So I'm going to run mimikatz.exe. Let me enlarge it. In this stage, it's not easy to save defaults, so I would like it, I'll make it a little bit larger so that everybody could see. And as you see the source, you can download the tool. It's really on the top right now, and it's now on the blacklist by Microsoft. Yes. So some dump hashes. Oh, what's wrong with this? Okay. That's better. And some dump hashes. Yeah. Oh. It looks like it's not working at this stage. That's interesting. Yeah, it's hushes. Okay, I know. That's the blonde thing, you know? Yeah, I'm sorry it's in French, because the author said that it should be only in French, just, you know, to save the world. Yeah. I need to put a path to the place in which hushes are saved. So it's going to be the sum. And then it's going to be D in this case. So let me do this. And here I will also put D Windows System 32 config and system. Now it's better. Cool. Yeah. Do you know something that is called Syskey? Yes? So Microsoft is claiming. You know what I'm talking about. Microsoft is claiming that it's not possible to do this. Well, as you see, we are able to dump the hashes in the offline mode, and we are able to do a little bit more things, because in this case, we are getting access to the SUM database, and if you are doing this online, and we're going to do this tomorrow, I will show you how to dump things that are kept in the memory using local security authority. It's a pretty cool situation. Okay, so having an offline access, even if you would like to recover your password, as you see, it's possible. So let me close this one. And let me restart. And I will show you what is the result of the whole situation. Okay, so let me restart the machine. And let me be back to the presentation. So, why do we use an offline access? All the situations that consider, for example, deleting log files whenever your disk is full, whenever you would like to reset your password, whenever you would like to inject something, but also we use offline access if you would like to, for example, recover your data. Your disk is destroyed, and then you need to take the disk, connect it somewhere else, repair it, and so on. So that's something that we usually ignore. So what is the solution? Tell me. Cryptography, right? If you would like to avoid this situation, you need to use some piece of cryptography. It may be a BitLocker or it may be something else that will actually protect you from getting access in the offline mode. BitLocker is a technology to protect you from stealing your laptop. Well, it cannot protect you from that, but it will protect you from not getting access to your data in this case, right? So it may be BitLocker or something else. That's going to be useful in this kind of situation. Okay, so from the penetration testing perspective, whenever you jump into a company, you just enter the building, the offline access is the maximum privilege that you have, and at the same time, the minimum one, right? You can just, you know, hand the pen drive to this nice lady sitting there and say, like, oh, I'm applying for a job. Could you please print a CV for me because I've forgotten? Will you help in this kind of situation? Because I will. And then you're like, I'm done. So that's one of the situations. Okay, so coming back to demo, let me click this button here. Ouch. Right? So what normally should appear under this button? This is Utilman. I should have like a keyboard and so on, right? Here. but I don't. That's one of the situations, of course. So, net user, administrator, password, domain. You want to reset it? Here you have, right? And the best thing is that if you do this, because, you know, in the other building of the company, nobody is protecting the server that is standing over there, and this is the backup domain controller, then it's going to replicate. Yay! Okay, so let me do not reset my password. Yeah. So this is a kind of problematic situation here. Okay, so the next thing to discuss is an incorrect access control. And what I mean by this is that every situation in which you set up some specific privileges for a user, for a group, and so on, then you need to think twice before you do this, because usually the default settings are enough. For example, whenever you create a service, the one that is running in services.msc, the service, then, and I see it very often whenever developers create it, they put it in some other folder rather than, for example, system32 or program files, while it's normally possible to inherit the permissions, but when you put it somewhere else, then you are like, maybe I should give to somebody some more permissions than he really needs. So the problem here is that we do set up an incorrect access control. We do not control how the files that are, for example, services are running. What kind of permissions do they have? Are they running on the local system account? If they are, then we are like done. And there is also another story, is that it would be very, very sweet if we could bypass all ACLs on the folder, don't you think? Yeah, I think so. If you can get access to the resource, what can you do? If you're an admin, that's pretty simple. You can take the ownership. But, you know, there are better ways to do this, and I would like to show you that we definitely should not ignore this. Okay, so first demo. It's about backup read and backup write permissions. So whenever I go to my folder, which is in this case backup read, and I try to open it up, you see that access is denied. And yes, I am an admin, but that's not a point here. I could click continue and the world will be boring. So let's do something else. So if I go to properties, security, and I click administrators, you can see that all access is denied. Yeah, I've done it. Okay, but let me bypass it, okay? So I need to run for that a tool that is called Robocopy. You know the tool? Sure. So let me quickly show you. Robocopy. And I'm going to copy all things that are in the backup read to C users. Administrator desktop backup write. And as you see, I was not able to do this. Yeah. So skipped one. That's pretty interesting. If I try to copy the file, just copy the file, I do have the message that access is denied. Okay, so in Robocopy, you've got something very, very nice that is called the B switch, and you are using something that is called backup mode. Technically, it means that you are actually getting access to the privilege that is called backup read, backup write in this case. So let me show you how it works. Robocopy slash B, and then I do have a one file that is copied. So let me jump here and do the desktop, and I'm going to go to backup write, and I do have this file here. So I will delete it just to show you how it works one more time with the B switch. I've copied one file. Nothing is skipped, and I do have this file again. So we've just bypassed, using the backup mode, all ACLs that are on the folder, and probably a couple of years ago, you've noticed that whenever you were doing the backups, some files were not backed up. And the question was why. Maybe it's a matter of permissions. For example, some files are open and so on. And now life is nice because since Windows Vista, we are actually using this a little bit more extensively. And that's why a couple of backup operations are a little bit more comfortable. So this is the first thing that we should not ignore. The second thing is that I do have here my service folder. And as you see, there are two files, good and bad. Good is good, bad is bad. How surprising. OK, so the service is running on the good file. And I would like to show you that from services.msc. Let me go here, sort by description. And this is the pool of service running here. So it's my service good.exe. And as you see, it's started. So let me ask you the question for another sausage. How do we discover services that are not Microsoft-based? Give me the name of the tool. MSConfig. That's a good one. Sausage? Yeah, I love it. Yeah. You don't want it? You can share. OK, it's not VG. Of course. OK, so MSConfig is one of the issues, definitely. Autoruns, I would also say. This is a tool written by Mark Rusinovich. And you can see the services that are not Microsoft-based. And in this case, I would like to show you one kind of vulnerability. So let me first open the registry. So let me open it up. And I do have here a WinLogon key. And as you see, nothing looks weird. Everything is legit. So I would like to show you how to, being a print operator, impersonate yourself into a local system account. Sounds interesting? So how to do this? OK, so let me switch user and log in as the account. I bet you know the guy. He's not a positive character. And let's go to the C drive, to my service. And Freddy is going to inject his file to the file of the service that is running on the local system account, which means that this guy, by just putting the file alive, can impersonate himself into the local system account. OK, so it's going to be a simple operation. Rename. And check this out. I'm doing this alive. Service is running. It's sorted. Yes. And good. That's it. So let me switch user to administrator. Yeah. And the only thing we need to do is to wait for the situation, like a maintenance and so on, so that we can restart the service, because Freddy is not allowed to do this. He could not even open the services.msc console. But let's pretend that we are restarting the server. And I will just restart the service, OK? So restart. Yes, and let's go to the registry. And that's it. You see? The additional entry. So what happened, what just happened, is that because of the inappropriate permissions on the folder under which we do have the services running or other operating system files that are taken into consideration during the regular boot up process, because this is a service, we were able to impersonate ourselves from being a print operator to the local system, which is higher than admin. And then, stage is yours. And this is something, it's one of the sins that is committed in many organizations. Whenever you are doing the scanning and checking out what is on the server, on the user's computer, and so on, there is usually some kind of service that is running with some specific account because, you know, let's say accountant department, they need a special database, and the database, it's not in the program files, but it's somewhere else, and so on, and so on. Yeah, okay, this is one of the contexts that you can use to get access to the operating system. And you can do whatever you want. As you see, we do have a WinLogon key that was overwritten, so I think it's enough to prove that we have the full control here. Okay. So, using old technology to warm us up, let me ask you the question. Who of you has Windows 2000 working in a production environment? Put your hands up. Okay. 30%? Okay, so let me go deeper. NT40. Oh my gosh, okay. Okay, so like maybe 2% of you. Interesting. Okay, so now 3.51? Anybody? You? Oh my gosh. You need to come and get it, okay? Everybody feels sorry for you. Really? Okay. So, definitely we used to use the technology that is up to date. Something really obvious, but as you can see, not that much. There are a couple of technologies that are used nowadays in many infrastructures. For example, something that is called software restriction policy that is working on the top of Windows 2003 server. So software restriction policy, briefly speaking, this is a technology that is used to prevent users from running specific applications, right? That's why we do have AppLocker right now. It's very similar, but it's better. Or maybe let me put it this way. AppLocker, it's working, while SRP it's not. And I would like to show you how it's not working. So software restriction policies used by many organizations. This is Windows XP, and I do have the policy here set up. This is Susanna, and she's a user. So if Susanna would like to run Notepad, and let me run Notepad. You've got information that we cannot open it because it's prevented by the software restriction policy, blah, blah, blah. Really? And the thing is that there is a process that everybody knows, explorer.exe, and who owns it? Who is the owner of explorer.exe? A user, right? Susanna, she's the owner. So if something is based on explorer.exe, we're like, what the hell? And specifically, if that's this thing has something to do with security. That sounds really interesting. So let me jump to tools that Susanna just uploaded in her job. And one of the tools, it's called GP Disable. This is one of these tools that you cannot actually find in the internet right now, but I'm the fan of preserving the history, so if you want the tool, I'm happy to give it to you. Let's make sure the history won't die. Notepad.exe. And here we go. Yeah, so this is the old technology, not that old, because it's Windows Server 2003 that we are still using. And sometimes, because many people use XP still, and they still do use software restriction policy, this is the same situation. So it's a kind of problematic thing. I would like just to tell you that the old technology sometimes may be really, really tricky. Okay, another thing to discuss is the encryption in general. So we are not using encryption because, I don't know, it's just complicated. Whenever you listen to the traffic on the client side, whenever you plug into the socket that is somewhere available in a wall and so on, whenever you do the Wi-Fi scanning, and that's what guys from Sweden gonna tell you on their session, then you can see that actually there is a clear text running around. So I would like to show you a small demo that is related to the last events with LinkedIn. Rings a bell, right? Yeah, of course, it was pretty serious. But no mercy. I would like to show you the situation that I really love about this portal. So let me first open up the browser. World largest network. Love it. Okay, so that's it. And I do have also a tool that is called Fiddler. You know it? Yeah, okay. So this is the web debugger, and I have it here. So let me do like this. And I'm using here HTTPS. And in Fiddler, what I've done, I've made myself like a man in the middle. So tools, Fiddler options, HTTPS, and I do have here the possibility to decrypt HTTPS traffic. Nowadays, we are not fighting with cryptography because it's pretty strong. We are fighting with the weaknesses of technology, and this is what I'm going to show you. So I'll be technically man in the middle, which means that if there's a user establishing connection with LinkedIn, I'll be the one that the user will be establishing connection with, and I will be also the one to establish a connection with LinkedIn. Very typical situation, so-called HTTPS filtering in many organizations, just to make sure that within HTTPS traffic, there's nothing bad coming inside. And sincerely, I'm traveling a lot. Many hotels, they also do HTTPS filtering. And this is not a very positive situation because some applications are simply speaking badly written. And LinkedIn is, you know, I don't want to say one of them, but I just said it. So what can we do? Okay, Susanna, boss, at live.com. And the password's going to be secret password? No? Yeah, and we are logged in. This is Susanna. She has her own identity in US. What do we have here? Let me enlarge it. And let me find the traffic that is responsible for logging Susanna in. This is HTTPS, web forms, and this is the Susanna's password. Yeah? Ouch. I know. So, what should be here? Some piece of encryption, at least. So even if we are using HTTPS, it doesn't mean that we are secure. Yeah, somebody cannot sniff us, but somebody can be a man in the middle. So in this case, you can actually read what is inside the tunnel, and as you can see, the password is not encrypted. Who of you uses LinkedIn? Put your hands up. Yeah, okay. Almost everybody. Yes? Pay attention to that. And of course, I'm not talking about HTTP, which is totally easy, because our password's gonna go in the clear text, obviously. Okay, so the next thing to show you, let me close this one, is that installing pirated software. Yeah? Look closer, yeah? Okay. I would like to have this version, it's like. Okay, so this is the picture that I've taken when I was on a vacation in Syria. And as you can see, there are many versions being installed. So the question is, do you have, and you don't need to answer, do you have like your own repository with the files that you have just in case you need them to install them, like a VMware installation files, Office installation files, and so on. Because usually IT people, admin, they do have like their own repository, right? And whenever you need something, they're like, ah, toolkit, and they're, here you have, easy, couple of seconds. So the question is, who checks for the signatures? Yes, because what they do, they install software using administrative privileges. Yeah, of course, because who else could do this? They do have their own repository, while somehow it may appear that inside this repository there is something going on and the files are not signed because somebody injected malware in the installation file. The situation like from the dreams, right? You would like to have that as an attacker because this is, he's just clicking or she's just clicking and stuff is installing. Okay, so the thing to discuss is that UEC, in this case, it's obviously not a solution to help you out because you were accepting this anyway, right? You were an admin, you were installing the files. And I would like to show you the simple situation within which there is a file that has injected malware, and I'm going to show you how to inject it. And then, of course, the admin installs the software without checking for the file signature with the administrative permissions. Okay, but first, small thing. On Tehet, I made a small survey within you guys asking a couple of questions. Maybe you are the one that was asked on the audience. I don't know. So I've asked the first question. Do you check for the signatures before you install the files? Do you? Yeah, okay, so no. 20 of 20 people that I've asked said no. That's kind of scary. Maybe I was just, you know, asking the chef of the kitchen or whatever. I don't know. He's like, what is the signature and what is the file? Okay. The next survey. Do you perform the periodical checks on your repository? Do you check if the files are healthy? Do you scan them for with the antivirus software and so on? And the answer is no. So 80 of 20 people said, no, we don't do this. We just install the files. Of course, it wasn't that simple answer. It was a discussion, but this was the result. We're like, no, we are not doing this. Actually, I'm not thinking about doing this. Okay, so what's the problem? The problem is that, oh, I'm sorry. It may appear that we are actually having the file that was injected with malware, and let me show you that. Let me close all the stuff just to clear the view. Okay, malware. And what I do have here, it's a simply constructed demo. Here I do have the Word Viewer. If I go to Properties, you've got something at the top that is called Digital Signatures, and you can check out who signed the specific file. And this is the legit file. Another thing is malware that I have here to inject. And in fact, this is the engine that I'm using to, simply speaking, attach malware to the file. So, and in fact, that is my backup file, just in case it didn't work. So I'm simply speaking, infecting the Word Viewer with the malware. Okay, let me do this. Let me jump to the console. And let me switch to the Windows folder. Oh, not this one. Yes. And let me search for TXT files. Okay. This is not the one that comes here. So let me run malware.cmd. Yeah, okay. I like this. Infected successfully. Okay. And we run the installation file. This is the Word Viewer. Yeah, I would like to cancel that. And as you see, and I can do this here, it's a little bit larger. I do have something that it's saving in the Windows folder. So we do not check for the signatures, and this is the huge problem. If you are doing the penetration testing, and you may do the following situation, inject something into the toolkit that is usually available through share, and ask IT admin to install something for you. And that's like a proof. Okay. So let me switch to the next topic. Something that is called lack of network monitoring. Let me ask you the question. We are all sitting here and having fun and so on, but really, you don't need to answer, but would it be possible if somebody was sending out the data from your company to somewhere else using ICMP? Yes? If we put data in ping and ping Google, because users usually can ping stuff using ICMP protocol as an outgoing traffic, would it be possible? And usually, unfortunately, the answer is yes, because ICMP is just an innocent protocol that nobody's monitoring. It's actually pretty useful to check out if somebody's there. Of course, we can do this differently, specifically internally. We don't need to have ping available for Google, for example. But I would like to show you a couple of possibilities if it's about the monitoring the network traffic. So let me go to my presentation here. Okay. And the first thing to show you, so it's going to be the console. I'm going to go to my Windows, to my users folder, administrator, desktop, and yeah. And I'm going to show you first the DNS stuff. So DNS, it's the other thing. If we put a file into the DNS protocol, would it be possible to send it out from your company? I guess so. So this is how data may leak. Pay attention to this. So I do have here file to DNS tool. This is my tool. If you want it, come to me. Give me your pen drive and, you know, I'll give you the tool. Sincerely, give me. Okay, file to DNS. And what I plan to do, I plan to send out some file. So let me actually create the file. Let me do new text document. Let's call it very simply ABC, for example, and let's type blah, 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 hello world, and that's it. Okay, so it's abc.txt. And what the tool is doing is sending out the data to the nearest DNS that is around. So it has also its display mode. So as you see, blah, 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 hello world, being constructed into a query. And if you try to put it through some firewall, it goes through because it's a legal query according to RFC. So what do you think about that? Yeah, everybody uses DNS, right? Okay, so monitor the traffic. And to make it more geeky, I made it with the ASCII characters, so capital letters are represented by ASCII values so that you cannot actually recognize that it's so dangerous. And the other thing is ICMP, and I do have here MemoPad. Let me show you the MemoPad first. So this is the Raccoon application, and you can, you know, make some notes here, but when you run MemoPad through the console, it's getting really evil. So I will run first Wireshark. This is a tool by Laura Chappell to do the network monitoring. You can download this for free. I'm going to start monitoring. And I'm going to monitor ICMP traffic. I do have a filter here. So what I will do, I'm going to send memopad.exe. I'm going to send the file. So it's ABC. And I'm going to send it to 10, 10, 10, 100. OK. Where is that? Clear. ICMP. Apply. That's super interesting. Let me go like ping 8888. Oh, general failure. That's interesting. That's probably because I've made some switching before the presentation, if it's about the network. Local area connection, let me disable it and enable it. It's gonna be way, way better. Okay, adapter settings, enable, and let's try it out. Oh, that's interesting. Ping transmit failed, general failure. Okay. So, let me be back to this demo. This is one of the situations that demo gods really hate you. Let me be back to this demo. It's gonna work because it's super simple. And I would like to show you how to, simply speaking, send out the data within ICMP. Usually what is in ping, by the way? An alphabet, right? Whenever you ping somebody, then you've got the alphabet. So that's the case, and we will replace the alphabet with the data here. Okay, the next thing that I'm going to show you is in Active Directory users and computers. I'm gonna go capture interfaces again. Yeah. And clear it. Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, it's actually working. Okay, so Active Directory users and computers. And the thing is that this DLL that is checking for the password complexity, every time I reset a password, so let me do this, is sending it out through the network using an UDP. So this worked. That's nice. Let me show you. You see? Britney Spears. And the second UDP packet, this is actually her password. Ouch. So I made it really polite because I'm a polite person and I'm not sending this to the internet, but you can do this. And you can have this situation in your infrastructure. And I'm going to have the other service somewhere else, and I'm going to collect it. So monitor your traffic. OK. So let me switch back to the presentation. What you see is not what you get. So the best way to manage to figure out what is wrong within the operating system is to have at least two tools to manage the situation. Whenever you get the information, like browsing through console and so on, you check out what kind of files do you have. The question is, do you really believe to the picture that you see? Maybe you've got a rootkit and maybe something is further out. So I would like to show you that by using explore.exe, which is super, super easy, because as you remember, user is the one that is using explore.exe, that owns explore.exe, we can inject some DLLs into our own process. That's possible, which may be, for example, some malware that will do this under our identity. And the result is going to be that we won't see things as they really are. Okay. So let me switch to the operating system. This time it's going to be the client. We're going to play with pure evil if you are curious what is that on my next session. And I do have here a couple of libraries. This file system browser.dll, this is my library. But this logic NP easy namespace extension, this is actually an Explorer extension that you can download from the internet. So what I will do, I will inject myself using the CMD batch that I have here. And what I'm doing it's not super important. I'm just registering these DLLs, and that's technically it. And it's using, and because it's an extension to explorer.exe, I'm able to do this. Okay, so pay attention to things that appear on the desktop. You see this one? This is a fake computer. I call it fake, just to show you it's fake. But if I would like to have an injection into explorer.exe, like totally, everything that you see in your session is going to be fake. So if somebody would like to hide the file, that's one of the ways to do this. If I open it up, you see that there is a good file and the bad file visible. Let me go to the real Explorer, to the C drive. Oh, yep. And we've got, of course, the same files visible. But there is also a bad file that is not visible. And if I rename bad file to ugly and refresh the view, it disappears. And the problem is, it's not the matter of something being displayed in the console. It's not a system file. It's not a hidden file. It's a file that is filtered out through explorer.exe, which means you may totally do not know that something is actually happening. So the conclusion is always have at least a second tool to monitor what is happening in the operating system. Okay. So let me switch to the next demo. Is it scary so far? Yeah. Okay. That's good. They're from Poland. Yeah, I know. Such a shame. So we do put a little bit too much trust in people, to the both sides. So IT admins, they trust users, and IT admins, they just trust things that they get, like from the web browser and so on. So it's a little bit, I would say, organizational problem. And as you see, I put it as a sin number two, because if we do have too much trust in people, it causes a lot of problems. So one of the things to know about it is that if you have like many IT people working in your company, there is a chance that IT admins, they do trust each other, while technically IT admin is the person with the highest possible privileges in the network, and these people can actually do a lot of harm. So the question is, do you monitor yourselves? Yourselves. So do you monitor your colleague? And I would like to show you a couple of examples within which too much trust in people can be really deadly, and it might cause definitely a lot of damage in the infrastructure. Sometimes we need to follow the business. So business is the number one thing that we need to take care about. But as I said, IT admins, they do tend to take shortcuts. And sometimes these shortcuts are a little bit too scary. So the next demo is the too much trust in people. And I do have four demos for you. OK, so the first thing, let me open up the browser. Do you ride a horse? Yeah? Who of you rides a horse? OK, a couple of people. The other group is sitting at the computer. I guess so. Yeah, motorcycle, good. So if you ride a horse, you can buy socks for horses. Yeah, it's a real website, by the way. So I would like to show you a couple of things with Fiddler. So first of all, there is a huge discussion in between IT pros and developers, and usually IT pros, they do not have a hard, easy job to do because they get something from the developer, for example, the website, and there is a message, could you please publish it? And the question is, do you test out the website that you publish? like doing the penetration test and so on. Because in the network, there are so many websites that are vulnerable, and they're like vulnerable for years. When I started my security things, there are still the same websites that are vulnerable. And I'm like, oh no, not again. So I would like to show you one situation that is pretty positive if it's about the website itself. Let me refresh the website so that we know that we have it in Fiddler. Okay, so if you would like to buy yourself a socks for horses, then you can do this. Unfortunately, they are cheating a little bit because they do not have this nice purple coral colors that you have on the picture. They only have the gray ones and the white ones, but what we can do, let's buy one and let's add them to cart. Okay, as you see, it's $34.95. Okay, let me be back here. And I will do the same operation, but I'll go to edit, to rules, automatic breakpoints, before requests. And I'm going to monitor the things that are happening over here. So if I add socks to cart, then you see that there is this traffic happening. Let me enlarge it. And if you want to have them for $2, it's actually possible. And they're just socks, so you can imagine. Do you like Cisco stuff? And so on, right? So check out if you cannot have a free shopping or like, you know, Christmas gifts, whatever. Okay, so one of the things, they publish things before they even test it out. It can cause financial problems. That's pretty serious. Maybe not for socks, but for Cisco stuff, definitely, right? Okay, so other thing that I would like to show you, it's too much trust in people, but from a little bit different perspective. This is the website that it's pretty new. What's that about? So I made my own. And is your email listed in the spammers database? Yeah, check. Oh, that's the Fiddler happening. Yeah, let me run to completion. Now it is. So shocking. Another thing is Shodan database. By the way, it's really nice. ShodanHQ.com. Make sure you've got an account over there. I've checked for Florida's cameras, what kind of interesting thing you can, you know about people, what they are doing when nobody's looking. And you can actually know it. I know it's not very ethical, but it's so cool. So you can display a couple of things happening. And this is in Miami, so not very far away. And it looks like it's a hotel, so you know, you can expect many things happening here in a hotel, so let me browse to the other one. And this is actually in Warsaw. Now, it's pretty late in Warsaw, in Poland, but this is a kind of stock in which when it's day, during the day, you can see people working and so on, right? Whenever you see a couple of other countries, more like China and so on, there's a lot of things open like this. And including the situation when I was browsing last night, I discovered people that were replacing money in the ATM. Oh, so really, Shodan is just a perfect database of such solutions. As you see, this is Tampa, for example. You just put the name of the things that you would like to search here, the city name, you don't need to put it, of course, and you've got some search directory, so with the huge resources to browse through, it's really good. If you would like to have fun and feel, put yourself in the skin of kind of, you know, hawker or stalker or whatever. Sometimes it's just a pleasure. Webcam, Dreambox, default password, whatever. If you like to do Google hacking, it's no longer that fancy. You need to do some work. I'm lazy. So you've got a research mate over there. OK, so the last thing to show you regarding too much trust in people. Let me switch to the virtual machine. OK. Yes, let's refresh what is happening here. OK, let me close this one. Yeah. Is too much trust to IT people? So there's a kind of vulnerability in Windows. Well, Microsoft says it's a feature, you know the story, but I think it's pretty serious. It was possible to convert the static accounts to dynamic in 2003. Well, now it's not possible. You can only create a static user account or a dynamic user account. Usually we use static. And dynamic user account, that's something that we, you know, what is that about? So dynamic user account, this is an account that has its own time to life, so to enter TTL value, and time is trickling. And the problem is that when it reaches 0 seconds, the user account is gone. You're thinking like, can I have a revenge on my company? Yes, you can. This is for such situations. So check for this. Okay, entry TTL. My demo is constructed in the following way. So I do have here create ldf.cmd. And what it's doing, it's a very simple script, right? What it's doing is creating a user account with object class dynamic object. This is the difference. It's not a static account, the regular that we use. It's a dynamic account. And we are assigning the entry TTL value, which is the number of seconds that the account will be alive. And the best thing is that even if you do the recovery, it's not possible because dynamic accounts are not possible to be recovered. They are just gone like a shadow. So let me do one thing. In do it. I do have a loop that is creating a bunch of user accounts, dynamic accounts, with entry TTL values. Cool. So let me open up the script and let me copy the PowerShell command so that I do not need to write it. Yes, and that's going to be run as admin with Active Directory module. Okay. Awesome. Oh, okay, so let me copy it again. It looks like I haven't copied it, as it should be copied. Oh. Okay, Control C. Oh, what is wrong? Paste. Oh, that's interesting. Okay. So let me do like this. AD, it's going to be equal users. It's going to be fast. DC equals secure. And without the space, of course. And DC tech. So I need to specify the domain name. And then I need to measure object. Let's put the space here. Well, not here. Measure object so that I know how many accounts do I have in Active Directory. And I do have 40. Okay, so let me switch to the demo folder. And I'm going to run do it, which is creating for me the dynamic accounts. So this was pretty fast, nothing important. But if I go to edit console, to users, let me browse here. I do have here user 100, for example. This is the user newly created, and it has its own entry TTL value, which is now 83. Do you feel the tension? Okay, so let me show you again user 100. Entry TTL, 70. Yes? So what is happening right now? every second, if we get to zero, the user will be gone. And now, it's possible only to create dynamic accounts out of box, but you are not allowed to convert them from static to dynamic, from dynamic to static. So if you would like to have a revenge on your company, or maybe, I don't know, just have a joke, then you just need to create a dynamic users, like from now, and people who would like to manage this situation won't be able to convert them to static. That's awesome. So let me show you that user that is already dead, should be, and 17 seconds alive. Okay, sounds good. So let me switch to PowerShell and allow to measure it. And now you can see that it's 98. And they disappear every 5 seconds. But there is a service in the domain that is called the garbage collector, just to, you know, clean out a little bit the stuff that should no longer be in Active Directory. So let me go to my tools folder. And let me go to LDP tool. Yes, here we go. And what I will do connection bind, type the password of the admin, and then go to browse, modify, and I'm gonna enforce the cleaning a little bit by typing do garbage collection with value 1, add operation, enter, run it, and then I'll be back to the PowerShell, measure the number of objects, and it's 70. So if I clean out one more time, then it's 68. What do you think? That's kind of scary. So what I think it should be done, this is scene number one, which is maybe a little bit boring, but I think it's pretty reasonable. It's a lack of documentation. Do you agree with me? Yeah. So all these scary things, they may happen. But lack of documentation, that's something that is really serious, because if they happen, there will be nobody to help you out, specifically if it's about IT people that cause this damage. Okay, so make sure that you're gonna monitor anything that you have in your infrastructure. Lack of documentation, I would say it's not really an admin sin. I think it may be even a sin of a management that is not checking out for the documentation and so on. So some people that are responsible for quality assurance, that's the case. So it's just to tell you that lack of documentation usually causes a lot of problems. Whenever I'm doing the auditing, I always ask for documentation, and there's always answer, we have like maybe like from 2 years ago, or I don't know, where's the list of the server? And there's like, you know, where's the list of the server? Where's the list of the server? And everybody's searching for the list of the servers. It's like, I know them anyway, but this is you who need to know what is the list of the servers, right? Okay, so the summary. We've discussed several things that are happening in the infrastructure, starting from misunderstanding the password. I showed you that having the services running on the specific accounts, it's not a positive situation. Offline access is important. Lack of encryption. What do you have whenever you do not encrypt data? What are the solutions? Network monitoring, for example. So All the situations that are happening in the network, you should, as an admin, definitely know what is happening. And my goal here was that if you could take at least one sin from the presentation and apply it to real life, to your infrastructure, for example, do not have a service running on an account, because I'm pretty sure that you may have one, it would be fantastic. We'll make all the things a little bit more secure than they are. Couple of things to the end, related content. I'm delivering a session tomorrow. on kernel debugging. It's going to be heavy. This one was a little bit more entertaining. Tomorrow, I'm going to show you how to hide and detect traces if you are on the good side and on the bad side. And if it's about the resources, several things. You will get this presentation anyway, so I hope you found it useful. Yeah. So, thank you so much. If you could fill out the evaluation, I would really appreciate it. Thank you.